Hi, in this video we are going to talk about DNA libraries. You can find written notes on what we are going to discuss today at medicinecanbeeasy.com. The link is also in the description. So what are you going to learn in this video? I am going to explain what DNA libraries are, what types of DNA libraries we have, and how we can create them. We are also going to discuss why DNA libraries are so useful. In order to understand DNA libraries, you should already know what restriction enzymes and cloning vectors are and how they work. If you haven't heard about them yet, then I strongly recommend you watch our two videos we made where we explain everything you need. The link is in the description. Okay, so let's start. DNA libraries are collections of cloned DNA fragments. Imagine that we isolated all of the DNA from human cells, cut it into fragments, inserted it into cloning vectors, and then let them clone in bacterial cells. That way we would get a DNA library. Now there are two main types of DNA libraries: genomic DNA libraries and complementary DNA, cDNA libraries. A genomic library contains copies of every DNA sequence in the organism. To make a genomic library, we take DNA from cells and cut it with restriction enzymes. The fragments are then inserted into vectors and cloned. The problem with genomic libraries is that because we clone the whole genome, the library also contains non-coding DNA segments. What's also important is that you must choose your cloning vectors based on the length of DNA you want to insert. For example, for the human genome, yeast artificial chromosomes were used because they can carry large DNA fragments. The second main type of DNA libraries, complementary DNA, cDNA libraries, contain DNA copies made from mRNA molecules. For that reason, cDNA libraries only consist of DNA sequences that are transcribed into mRNA and that were transcriptionally active at the time the library was made. In order to create a cDNA library, first a short oligodeoxythymidines molecule must anneal to the polyadenine tail at the end of an mRNA. This molecule serves as a primer for an enzyme called reverse transcriptase, an enzyme isolated from retroviruses, that uses the mRNA as a template to synthesize a complementary DNA strand, cDNA. The mRNA is then partially digested with the enzyme RNase H. The three prime ends of the remaining mRNA serve as primers for DNA polymerase, which synthesizes a second DNA strand. DNA ligase then seals the nicks in the DNA backbone. The result is a double-stranded cDNA molecule that can now be cloned. If you think about the process again, you may realize that cDNA differs from standard DNA because it does not contain non-coding sequences, as it was made from mRNA. cDNA libraries are useful when we want to study genes that are expressed under different conditions, or when we want to compare expressed genes from different tissues. So now that we have created a library, how do we find a specific gene in it? For this process, called library screening, we can use several approaches. One method uses a probe, a DNA or RNA sequence that is complementary to some part of the gene we are interested in and that we want to identify. The probe binds to these complementary DNA sequences in the clones and basically shows us the location of the gene we are looking for. Of course, the probe must be labeled so that we can identify it. Probes used to be labeled with radioactive isotopes, but now they are labeled with compounds that undergo color reactions so that they can be identified. If you would like to ask where we get such probes, then the answer is that they can be obtained from similar genes from other organisms, or they can even be synthetically produced. Another method that is used for screening DNA libraries is finding the protein product of the gene we are interested in. The DNA library is cloned in an expression vector, a vector that ensures that the protein product of the cloned gene is produced. The clones are then tested for the presence of the protein product by using different chemical tests. Finally, we should say that even though DNA libraries are still important today, they have been largely replaced by new genomic techniques, about which we are going to talk about in the future videos. Okay, so this is it. Thank you so much for watching. If you found this video helpful and you'd like to watch more videos on genetics or medicine in general, please subscribe. Thank you again, and see you soon.